Let me see. Yes, shalom everyone. This is Amir Tsarfati. I'm together with Michael Lay and Barry Stagner.
Shalom.
Shalom. And we are in Cape Town, South Africa. We would love to show you the view from our hotel, but unfortunately it will mess up our tech because of the lighting issues. So you'll see it at some point. Anyway, we want to give you a very short Middle East update, followed by ministry update regarding South Africa. So Pastor Barry, can you start with a prayer and then we'll jump into it?
Lord, we thank you for travel mercies and getting us all here in a timely manner. Lord, we thank you for this opportunity to speak truth about what's going on in your world and the nearness of your return, Lord. Mm-hmm. So we pray your blessings on this time together and your anointing as well on both the words that are spoken and the ears that hear. Mm-hmm. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. So again, shalom, everyone. And we are in Cape Town tomorrow, awaiting his return. It's a sold-out event, packed with almost 2,000 people, I think. And we're expecting a wonderful time of fellowship with the local saints here. But I did want to give you an update. President Joe Biden just left Israel. He's on his way on Air Force One to Jeddah in Saudi Arabia. And against everything he said throughout his campaign and his early stage of presidency, he is going to meet today with Mohammed bin Salman, MBS, and he's going to shake his hand and he's going to beg him to increase oil production. All these three things are something that the Saudis are expecting from the president to do. And let me tell you something, they're not going to increase production. They will not do that, at least not as if they are automatically answering his request. They will, as we say in Hebrew, they will present the revenge cold. And this is how it's going to happen. The Palestinians had a visit today by President Biden in Bethlehem and also in a hospital on Mount of Olives. And they're not happy with this visit as well. They did not get from him any clear promise that Jerusalem is the capital of the future Palestinian state. And they did not get from him any promise about a consulate in Jerusalem, any promise about removing the PLO from terror organization, and about removing also and about reopening the PLO office in Washington, D.C. None of these things happened. All the amazing things that President Trump did, this current administration has a hard time reversing it. And especially when it comes to the Abraham's Accords. Abraham Accords are the most amazing thing that happened in the Middle East over the last 30 years, that's for sure. And even the fact that Saudi Arabia opened its skies to all Israeli airliners is not related to the U.S. president visit right now. It is something that has been cooking for at least a year and a half, if not 2 years, way before this government of change started. Prime Minister Netanyahu already worked with one of the princes of one of the princes of Saudi Arabia that he actually visited Israel. And Netanyahu, according to foreign reports, visited Saudi Arabia quite a few times. In fact, the Saudis are engaged in negotiations with Israel about something completely different. And let me explain what I'm saying. When Israel had agreed on peace with Egypt, Israel pulled out of Sinai. Now, right next to Sinai, on the Red Sea, there are two islands that Israel used to control, Sanfir and Tiran. These islands were evacuated by the Israelis. They were given back to Egyptians with UN forces there. And that is, of course, in order to allow Israeli free passage in the Red Sea. That was part of the agreement. Israel has to agree to any change of the status in Sanfir and Tiran. Guess what happened? Over the last couple of years, Mohammed bin Salman is building NEOM, the big, high-tech, futuristic city by this Red Sea, and he wanted those islands. They are important to him. So he worked on a deal with the Egyptians to swap some stuff and get those islands to himself. However, he couldn't get them because it requires an Israeli approval. So you see that these things have been in the works for the longest time. Israel gave its approval, and that, of course, paved the way. It has nothing to do with President Biden's visit. However, President Biden needed to show some success in his foreign policy. Some success in something, by the way. Because the day he left and landed in Tel Aviv, the inflation rate in America was published 9.1%, and we're talking about 40 years record high, and not to mention many other parameters in the economy that are really bad. So he ran away from his domestic problems to kind of appear as someone who has some great international political achievement, but all of that is just something that has been already fixed and agreed upon long ago. Now, his visit serves his government of change and our government of change. It doesn't really reflect reality, but it serves both in order for re-election, for the Israeli Lapid, for his interim prime minister right now. He wants to run again. He wants to appear as someone as of a statement. And of course, President Biden declared that he wants to run again. I'm not sure how it's going to happen, but never mind. But all I'm trying to say, the Palestinians are angry. The Israelis understand this is just, some sort of something that only those who hate Netanyahu could look at as achievement. The Saudis can't wait for him to land and to see him begging for the increase of oil production, and they will not agree, and you will see that. And if they will agree later on their own terms. And so we are watching a lot of stuff going on. This interesting visit may have only done one thing, caused Iran to feel even more insecure and run even faster towards its bomb. And I told, if you are following me on Telegram, you know for a fact that the Iranians already have enough material that is military grade, and I'm talking about uranium, for a bomb. Not for one, for at least five. Everyone knows that in the Israeli military establishment, we all know that. The only thing that is left for the Iranians to do is to give an order to assemble a bomb. They have got everything they need. They just need to put a bomb together, put it on a nuclear warhead, and that's it. The thing is, nobody wants to admit that they have it. They are already what we call threshold country when it comes to nuclear. Threshold means they have it. They never really built a bomb yet. Now, they don't need the approval of America or any deal with anyone if they already have whatever they have, because they can already do it under the ground in a place that no one knows. And that's it. They're laughing. They're disrespecting everyone. And that's what we have. And so just wanted to update you. Iran has enough uranium for bombs. Everyone knows that. Palestinians are not happy. The Saudis are waiting for Biden to come and beg for increase of oil production. And everything that happened over the last 3 days, it was only to serve interest of two weak leaders. Lapid, our prime minister, who is an interim prime minister, who has not even enough to form any government in the future, and President Biden, that enjoys the lowest approval rate in the history of American presidents ever since they started taking those polls. Under 30%. Some give him 33, some 30, some 29. Unheard of. So having said all of that, guys, it's time for us to discuss this whole thing from the American perspective. Mm. What do you say, Pastor Barry?
Well, I think just from a general prophetic perspective, it's interesting to see somebody like MBS taking center stage and having so much control over so many different facets of so many different countries. And you pointing out NEOM, that great $500 billion city that he wants to build, this the world's most technologically advanced city. Mm-hmm. And yet here he is, you know, Saudi Arabia obviously has had an influence for many years because of oil, but now they're impacting various nations, inflation rates, and, you know, kind of holding hostage the world. And his voice is becoming louder and louder and louder to the degree that his place is going to be obvious when someday Israel is invaded from the north and he says, hey, what are you guys doing? And all other voices, the power brokers of the world, are silent at this time. And yet here, I think it's really, really fascinating that Mohammed bin Salman is rising to the surface and having a voice on the world stage.
They tried to put him down, if you remember, in 2018 when you know, Khashoggi was killed in the Saudi consulate in Istanbul. Of course, the Democrats said that bin Salman is a murderer. Even Erdogan said that he's a murderer. Now Erdogan is crawling all the way to accept MBS's approval. And MBS was there at Erdogan. Erdogan, for the first time ever, went up to the airplane to receive MBS from the plane. Mm-hmm. He didn't even wait for him. Yeah, it was like, I really want you. Thank you for coming. I'll do whatever you want. It was amazing, quite amazing. But it seems like Biden's problems back home are beyond what he can ever, you know, imagine. The economy is really going down. But not only that, it seems like some of the things that he has been doing in order to bypass the latest ruling of the Supreme Court regarding Roe versus Wade, it seems like he's truly making now hospitals as abortion clinics. Now hospitals, now ER rooms in hospitals are now becoming abortion clinics because of the you know, federal instruction to you know, do stuff against the legislation of those countries. I know Texas is suing the federal government over that issue. So you know, we see a lot of stuff going on right now in America, and I there are some rumors that President Trump made up his mind already, and that he will announce in September that he's running again. Honestly, Netanyahu also is, you know, going to run. In Israel, elections are November 1st. Are we going to see another way of God giving us a chance for a few more years of sanity? Or is this something of a lost battle already. I don't know, because we've seen along the history how the enemy tries to do something, God many times suppressed it, and then people wanted more, and then God suppressed it. Because, you know, and Mike, you've said that many times, that the restraining power of the church, of the believers, is still there. We're like that salt of the earth that is slowing down the decay.
Yeah,
you've said that.
I've said that, and a few things that I think are worthy of note is, number one, Biden as a human being, people, including the right, are beginning to feel bad for the man.
Including the left, you mean?
No, I'm saying including the right. Now, the right is saying, this man, as a man, deserves better. The left, in a way, in fact, I'm not even going to say in a way, I believe the left is abusing this man as a man. Let me elaborate. They're allowing him to speak in cameras. They're doing the absolute best they can to pre-program what he's supposed to say. His gaffes are numerous. His trips are numerous. Even when he was in Israel. Yeah.
He started the day not before 11 a.m.
Yep. And, and he also put his hand out.
Yep.
And there was no one there.
No one.
If you follow me on Telegram, I posted a video from yesterday in Israel where he finished speaking, and he was shaking
his hand to the air.
The hand of an invisible person once again.
So what I'm saying, Amir, is that the leftists are even viewing him as a liability. And many of the leftists are starting to say, we have a problem here, because they knew he was going to be their puppet anyway. We've said that for many months. And he is and was and continues to be. But now even the right is saying, do this man a favor.
Yeah.
Do this man a favor. Look what you're putting him through. Yeah. How would you or you like to be put in that place and have constant embarrassment on the camera when you could make the hard decision to switch leadership? So that's part of the equation that may give us. It may give us not that. Can I say this on camera? Mm. The options, at least for the Americans, is that you have a situation that is unideal. Mm-hmm. Okay? There are other words I could use. Whether you're Republican, Democrat, Independent, whatever. It's all unideal. When I vote what is the least of the least of the evils.
Yeah.
It's all evil, but I'm going to vote the least of the evils. It's not that I'm saying I'm voting for something perfect. But we're at the point now where in the left, with a lot of their leaders, they're so bad. Also, Kamala Harris, a lot of her staff has resigned because she's just impossible to work with. Do we have a Josiah reform?
Yeah, the question that I'm asking myself is, will the establishment allow both Trump and Netanyahu run again? In Israel, Netanyahu is standing for a trial, and will they somehow do something using the judicial system that is in their hands to stop him from doing that? Will they come up with something against President Trump last minute to prevent? That's the enigma to me, because it is obvious to me that if both men ran for office right now, they would win, whether it's Trump or Netanyahu.
Right.
But we all know that the system, there's that deep state that is not allowing them both to run. And the question is, what will they pull out of their sleeve last minute to somehow use the power that they have been abusing for the last few years to stop that from happening? Now, I'm not sure what's going to happen. And honestly, I don't care, because as believers, we don't have to feel depressed and oppressed and, afraid. You know, Jesus promised tribulations in this world. He said, in this world, you will have tribulation. But then he said, be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world. We are not to be afraid or angry. We need to be on our knees praying, but we need to also remember that our hope is not in any politician. Our hope is not in any parliament or in any political party. Our hope is not in anything but Christ himself. And so whether the person we want to win is going to win or not, it's not going to get God off his throne. And we know the end of the story. Of all people, we know the end of the story. The question is, how long will this current chapter be? That's it. That's the only thing we don't know. Will God intervene now and do something, or will he allow the affairs of man to cause everything to deteriorate more and more and more? That's an interesting question.
Well, I think that's a great question, simply because there is such a place to where humanity is going to arrive at a point of no return. Mm-hmm. And we see this presented quite vividly in Romans chapter 1, mm-hmm. where there's a moral digression that begins with the denial of God as creator. And then there's sexual immorality that follows that. And then you find finally God, after having giving them up to uncleanness mm-hmm. and giving them up to their own decisions regarding moral standards, he finally gives them over, which is an irreversible state. He gives them over to a debased mind to do those things that are not fitting. And then 31 and 32 of Romans 1 describes really the United States and much of the world and its moral standards. And so I believe that there is a point to where we have reached that place where God has pre-appointed a time in history where he's going to snatch the church off the surface.
It's just that we don't know that time.
We don't know that time.
That's what
but
I mean.
But the interesting thing about that, Amir, I think a lot of people overstep what scripture says and go beyond what is written by saying we can't know anything.
No.
You know, even when Jesus said no man knows the day or the hour, he followed that with a major description of what to be looking
for. Of the times and the seasons.
Yeah. Even though, you know, we don't know that moment in time. But, you know, I think we also need to understand that it is that. It's a day and an hour that is already known by the Father.
That's true.
And so that point in time is a calendar date, mm-hmm. a tick of the clock, where everything's just over.
Yeah, that's what Jesus said when he talked about the fact that for men, today or tomorrow is not important. But for him, he needed to do certain things a certain day.
That's right.
There was an appointed time. Mm-hmm. I have a whole message called God's Appointed Time. But before we kind of finish, because I have to run away anyway, I wanted also to let you know that we're in South Africa, not for nothing. This is something that we've been working on for a long time. We've got a wonderful team here that we met with almost on a monthly basis in order to prepare this tour. All of our events are fully booked, sold out, with thousands of people in each city. Everything is on our website. I just want you to know that there is another dimension to this visit. And Pastor Barry, do you want to elaborate on it?
Yeah, it's interesting. This is my eighth time in South Africa. Wow. We actually had planned that we sent families from our church to the Paarl Valley, which is just north of here, and planted a church in Paarl, South Africa. And so I've grown to love this area and the people of this area. And South Africa is a wonderful country, and to see what God has been doing. And my very first trip, within 48 hours back in 2004, God spoke to my heart very, very clearly. I'd only been on the ground for less than 2 days, and the Lord said, plant a church here.
Wow.
And 2007, we sent our first family over to begin that work. And then now there's a thriving church in Paarl, Calvary Chapel Paarl. And while I was here on that visit, I was talking to my wife on the phone. We'd gone up to a pretty sparsely populated area. And I was talking to her. I was having her pray for me as I was getting ready to speak to a group of young people. And as she was on the phone with me, she said, you know, I'm kind of seeing a vision here of lights going off. And as she's describing what she's seeing, I'm seeing it across this huge valley and plain on the mountains across the way. And there's no people out there. There were no buildings. And I just started seeing lights out there. And it was amazing she's speaking it, I'm seeing it. And I went and shared it with one of the local South African pastors. And he said, you know, there's about a century-old vision of lights coming in
prophecy
off the Western Cape and spreading throughout mm-hmm. Africa. And as I was talking with my wife a couple of days ago, she said, remember that vision? And so we're really hoping that maybe somehow in all that God is doing and all that he has been speaking to this country, maybe this will be a spark, a catalyst to bring about revival and a great awakening in this country. We know countries all over the world need it. America certainly needs a great awakening, as does Israel. Mm-hmm. And but I'm excited about this because we were talking at lunch today. I can say without hyperbole or exaggeration, the time of preparation for this particular trip has been the most spiritually attacked time I've ever experienced in my ministry life. Never experienced the things that we've been going through these past 2 or 3 weeks. And
tell me about it.
When God's going to do something, the devil is in. And so be blessed because, you know, God's got to use somebody. And he always just, you know, raises somebody up from the dust and puts his hand on them. And we want to play a part in what God is doing. And I absolutely believe that God has called us here for such a time as this. And so keep us in prayer.
Yes, yes. We want to also share with you that unlike a lot of people that travel and teach, we really do not do that for any financial gain. We do not receive anything from anyone over here. We're not charging. We never set a price on our coming. In fact, we actually shoulder all the expenses of flights and hotels and food and transportation and our time. And that's because we want to make sure that when we go by the leading of the Spirit and not by the leading of wallets or bank accounts. Mm-hmm. So when people write us and ask, how much do you charge to come and speak? I would say, don't ask this. Ask us if we can come, if the Holy Spirit is leading us to do that, because that's the only thing that makes us go. And this is why when we travel together or when I travel alone, we know it's the directing of the Holy Spirit. We know that it is something that the Lord told us to do, or else we would have not done that because there is no other reason for us to do that. And that is connected to what you just said, that we are experiencing a lot of spiritual warfare before we go because the enemy does not want us to go. Because, you know, we're doing that which the Lord is calling us to do, and not anything else. And so continue to pray for us that this will always be the case where the Spirit leads and not anything else. And we want to honor the Lord by the way we do things, and by also, I believe, and we were told that. We were told by the organizers here that we are a great testimony. Mike, can you share what they told us? About
It's like a relief that a lot of speakers that they bring in have big amounts of money they require,
or special
requirements, special accommodations, and so on. So one of the beautiful things, if I may say my perspective, is when you book different venues with people, and when they come and they say, "Can you come?" It's very convenient and nice that we book our own flights, we book our own hotels. And it makes it less for the organizer and the coordinator to worry about. It makes it easier for us. It makes it easier for them. And the one thing in this equation are just generous souls like you, people that just give based on what the Lord says should give on their heart. And what that does is it translates, just as the Bible says, people have been praying to hear the word of God or get guidance, and then the Lord answers it through the church worldwide. It's kind of like a beautiful tapestry. And
one of the great things, Mike, that is when you don't have any financial gain from these things, the best thing is that there is no size of any church that is out of your reach, and there is no country on planet Earth that is out of your reach.
You
will go to countries and you will go to churches, whether small or big. I always share with people, if it wasn't for a small church in Croatia that meets in a nuclear bomb shelter, I would have never come to Romania or Brazil.
Amazing.
These are two gigantic countries that are now wide open to behold Israel. All of that because someone, a pastor from a tiny church in a small city in Croatia, wrote me a text where he said, "I don't have the money to be able to afford bringing you over, but we would love you to come and teach our congregation." And I felt so strongly that I need to do that. I said, "Look, I never asked for any money or any, just if I'm going to hear that from the Lord, that this is what I need to do, I will go." And I went there and they were shocked, you know, about 100 people.
Yeah.
But among the 100 people, there were two people from Romania that live in Austria. And they opened Romania to me. And when I came to visit them in Austria, there were two people. One of them is from Brazil. They opened Brazil to me. Mm-hmm. So you see, when you say yes to a small thing that God leads you to, he will open the big doors of the big countries. And that has nothing to do with your, with who you are. It has to do with obedience to what he says. And that's
never despise, no. Never despise the small things. No. We also have that with the Ukrainian churches long before the invasion that served to be an amazing relationship. So really, thank you all for your trust, for your prayers, for your gifts, for your passion and your encouragement. It goes a long way.
Yeah. Well, thank you guys. This was a special update. We will continue to update you about the ministry here in South Africa. Keep us in your prayers and we love you. And Mike, do you want to conclude with a prayer?
Yeah, let's pray. Yes. Lord, I pray you will bless every viewer right now. Give us that excitement and passion for the end times. Keep our eyes fixed on you where that passion flows. And not on the problems around us. Yes. There will always be problems. And the Bible says they're even going to increase. So all the more to look to Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. It's in his name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. God bless you. And shalom.